words of power because we are kings and our words matter. What you'll be in your marriage, in your family, what you'll be in every area of your life, you can form a picture of that and keep that picture as the goal of your life and proceed towards that goal and the attainment of that goal. Mind is, should be used in a positive way like that.
My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold mine. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is.
Kingdom comes into you and you come into the kingdom, you become a kingdom person. But then after you enter, there's a whole lot there for you to know and to enjoy. There are a lot of privileges and blessings that are yours by virtue of belonging to this kingdom. Now, these privileges and blessings are much more than what you could ever conceive or imagine with your human mind. There is so much available for you as a kingdom person. That is why the mind has to be renewed, because a lot of people don't think in those terms, that these are possible, that these are the blessings that are available. So it is important for the mind to be renewed. That's why Paul says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind. Transformed by the renewing of your mind. Why? So that the will of God can be done. So that the perfect will of God may be done in your life, he says. Now God's perfect will for you is something tremendous. Something far beyond anything that you could conceive or imagine with your human mind. It is something absolutely amazing, because it is God's will. It is like that. It comes God-sized. It has God's quality. And therefore it's much bigger. And our mind needs to be renewed to understand that. So we've been talking about the mind a little bit, because You need to understand the mind. And I've been telling you, the mind is made up of imaginations. And mostly the Bible, in the Old Testament, if you read, the Bible talks about man's mind as wicked most of the time. Some people wonder, why is anything wrong with the mind? Is mind completely bad? They think that mind is something undesirable if it's wicked. And that's basically the way the Bible puts it everywhere. Then you must avoid using too much of this mind, because it can lead you into wrong things, they think. But it's not like that. God gave us the mind for a purpose. After the second chapter of Genesis, after sin came in, mind got corrupted. And Romans talks about the futility of mind, vanity of mind in Ephesians chapter 4. Mind got corrupted and affected through the fall. That is the fact. So from chapter 3 of Genesis, you see corrupted, affected mind, ruined by the fall. That's why it's always talking about mind that is wicked. Because the fallen man's mind is wicked. It has bad thoughts. It does wicked things and devises and conceives wicked things and executes wicked things. So mind is bad, it says. But when you come into the New Testament, you find the positive side of the mind. For example, Paul says, writing to Philippians in chapter 2, verse 5, he says, "Let this mind also be in you, which was in Christ Jesus." So now he wants the mind to be used very positively. He sees a positive use of the mind. He doesn't say, be careful about the mind, you know, don't use it, you know. It'll lead you wrong. No, he says, let this mind be in you which was in Christ Jesus. In Romans 12, 2, he says, let it be transformed. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so on. And in 2 Corinthians 10, verse 5, he says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, so that we may bring into captivity everything that is against the thought of Christ. Every thought that exalts itself against the thought of Christ. Mind must be subjected to the thought of Christ. It must align with the thought of Christ. We must make sure that the mind is ordered according to the word of God. So a lot of good things are said about the mind, in fact, in the New Testament, as you read about after Christ and the salvation. The believer's mind is something that we must pay attention to. The Bible talks about the mind and how important it is in the life of the believer. So I've been talking about the mind. I told you that mind is made up of imaginations. Mind is basically something that works by imaginations. When I speak to you, pictures are created in your mind. Words create pictures. Mind works with pictures. Mind is actually something that enables you to see things mentally. That's the way things happen. Now, God has got a positive use for the mind. I talked about the positive use as this. That is, God wants us to use the mind to remember the good things, so that we may encourage ourselves in bad times, during bad times, during difficult times. When you're going through some struggles in life, difficulties in life, the Bible says, rewind. Forget not all his benefits. Think about the good things that God has done, the miracles God has done, the wonderful things that God has done for you. Bring it to your mind. David prays, in fact, Lord, on the day when they gave such large amounts as offering for the temple, he was so impressed. He says, Lord, let this thought be always before their eyes. May they always keep looking at this as the picture of this nation and picture of who they are. Let this always be before their mind. Let it never depart from their mind, he says. So, God has a positive purpose, and that is to rewind, so that you may encourage yourself by rewinding and looking at the things that you've experienced in the past that are good, so that you may manage these things that you're going through now and be encouraged during difficult times. But not only looking back, looking forward also is possible with the mind. This is a very important feature. This is a very dynamic feature, because you are now looking forward. You are able to fast forward, in other words. You are able to see what you'll be 10 years from now, 20 years from now, and so on. God has given you the mind so that you can form a picture in your mind of what you will be, what your profession, you'll be in your profession, what you'll be in your marriage, in your family, what you'll be in every area of your life. You can form a picture of that and keep that picture as the goal of your life and proceed towards that goal and the attainment of that goal. Mind is, should be used in a positive way like that. So we've been looking at this positive aspect of the mind, particularly this fast forwarding business, you know, which is very important. This is a very important benefit of the mind, that you need to form a picture of what you need to be and become that picture in reality. All right, let me talk a little bit more about that. Turn to Romans chapter 4. We can learn from Abraham a lot about hope. We know we can learn from Abraham about faith because we have done so. We have looked at Abraham so many times, learning about faith. But in the same passage that teaches about faith, we're going to learn about hope also. Because Abraham knew not only how to operate by faith, but he also knew how to operate in hope. He knew how to use hope to turn around his life and to really enter into the destiny that God has planned for him. What God had planned for him is something that he would have never planned. If you left it to Abraham, he'd have said, he'd have given up. I'm 100 years old, my wife is 90, what do I want, you know? Let me just go about my business and forget about the possibility of having a child. But God wanted him to have a child, not just a child, but that he should be the father of many nations. This became his goal. This became his hope. And this passage is a wonderful passage talking about his faith as well as his hope. So let me point out something to you here. In chapter 4, let me read to you verse 17. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. Now notice, Paul, talking about Abraham, refers to what is written about Abraham in the Old Testament. He says, as it is written, I have made you father of many nations. It is written like that. Because God told Abraham, I have made you father of many nations. When did he tell him that he made him father of many nations? Not after he got a child. Abraham could not even have one child. That is when God met him and told him, I have made you a father of many nations. That sentence is in past tense. When God told him, he talked to him as if he has already made him the father of many nations, whereas he did not even have a child. He said, I've made you a father of many nations. It's in past tense because faith is always like that. Faith always sees the thing as accomplished. For example, Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 53 verse 5, if you read, literally gets a revelation of the cross. 800 years before the death of Jesus took place on the cross of Calvary, this prophet receives a revelation about the cross and what it means. So he literally sees the cross and what happens when Jesus died on the cross. And he says this. He says, he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. And then, I'm quoting verse 5. Then he says, and by his stripes we are healed. He's seeing something presently. A revelation is being given to him. So he puts it in the present tense. He says, by his stripes we are healed. I'm seeing Jesus on the cross, he says. He's wounded for our transgression. He's hanging there wounded. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him, he says. And by his stripes we are healed. He puts it in the present tense. But if you read 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 24, where Apostle Peter, after Jesus died and rose again. See, Isaiah prophesied 800 years before the cross and spoke about what he saw about the cross. Now Peter speaks after the cross and he puts it this way. He says, by his stripes you were healed, he says. See, he puts it in the past tense. See the big difference. Isaiah 53:5 puts it in the present tense because that's what he saw. Presently, he was looking at that as a revelation, so he put it in the present tense. He saw people being healed by his stripes. But Peter understood what happened on the cross as a revelation of what happened on the cross, which has just happened, and it's been some time now since it happened. So he looks back at the cross and talks about what has already been accomplished. The healing is already done, he says. You were healed. When he died there, you were healed. That is faith's language. Faith's language is always like that. It puts it all in the past tense. Right? So, here we have this statement by God. This is a faith language. This is the language of faith. What did God say? I have made you father of many nations. He talks in the past tense. If Abraham looked at God and said, Lord, wait a minute. You say, I have made you father of many nations. You have not made me that yet. I'm not even with one child yet. God would have said, well, I've decided, determined in my mind, it's as good as done. In my mind, it's done. Therefore, it's done. Therefore, I speak as if it's done. That's what faith is. Faith doesn't say it will be done. Faith says it is done. Faith doesn't say it'll be mine. Faith says it is mine already. That is what faith is. That's the special nature of faith. All right? Now, how did Abraham learn this kind of faith? This is something that doesn't come naturally, right? We always talk not in past tense, you know. If we say we got it, that means we have it, you know, as in such a way that we can see it. Otherwise, we won't say that we've got it, because that is faith language. That doesn't come naturally for us. We don't speak like that. How did Abraham learn this faith? Because this verse says that Abraham learned this faith from God, and he began to operate like God soon enough. How did he learn this faith? Now, how does faith come? The Bible says in Romans 10, verse 17, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So faith comes by hearing the word of God. But Abraham didn't have a Bible, didn't have a church like this to go to hear, and to develop and grow and cultivate his faith. So how did his faith come? And that is where you need to look at this verse. It says, as it is written, I've made you father of many nations, before God, who calleth those things that be not as though they were. That before God is a very important term there. Before God literally means, it seems, now the translation that I have is New King James Version. It translates it as in the presence of him, in the presence of him whom he believed. The King James has it, before God, who calls those things that be not as though they were. That before God literally means seeing God face to face, literally. So how did Abraham learn faith? He learned faith by looking at God. Looking at how God operates. He saw how God operates. Where did he see? Because God came to Abraham one day and told Abraham, who was at that time named Abram, without the H in his name. And God told him, look, hereafter your name is not going to be Abram, but it's going to be Abraham. Because Abraham means the father of many nations. Similarly, Sarai was turned into Sarah with an H, because this meant that she's going to be the mother of many nations. Now here, this couple, they don't have a child. They're getting very old. No possibility. If you're going to name somebody, you look for an appropriate name, right? You won't name that person father of many nations, mother of many nations, when they don't even have one child, you know. You'll say, wait a minute, that name doesn't fit this person. Look at him, he's 100 years old, his wife is 90 years old. You want to name father of many nations as if he's going to give birth now? But God does that. He says, yeah, I'm going to name him father of many nations. I'm going to name her mother of many nations, because that's the way I am. That's the way I bring to pass things that I want to come to pass. Because I'm a God who calls those things that be not as though they were. The things that be not is that Abraham and Sarah don't have a child. That's the things that be not. That's what is not there. But God calls those things that be not as though they were. He calls them as though they've got a child. He calls them as though their children are like the stars of the sky. So God has this habit. This is the way God works. He calls those things that be not as though they were, so that when he calls those things that be not as though they were, the things that be not become. This is how he created in the beginning. The world was without form and void, empty, and it was full of darkness. With his words, he brought in everything that he wanted. You know, he didn't talk about what he didn't have. He talked about what he wanted to have. He called those things that be not as though they were. He said, let there be light when there was no light. You know, if I came into this place and if there's no electrical connection here, and if I said, turn on the light, I'd be a fool to say that. You know, you'd say, well, no wiring is done yet. No connection has been given. In the world, no electrical connection was given at that time. No light. God said, let there be light. And there was light. So this is the way God brings to pass everything that he wants to bring to pass. And Abraham began to catch on with God. Abraham began to understand that this is how God is. God is not like us. We are always talking about what we have. You know, we don't, you know, we say, well, let's speak the truth, you know. We say, this is the truth. My pocket is empty, so I'll just talk empty. But that's how we get more empty, you know. Because faith works in the opposite way. Faith doesn't talk about an empty pocket. Faith talks about how our needs are supplied by God according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. It doesn't look at the emptiness and speak emptiness. It speaks fullness. It talks about how the needs are met. That's how faith is. But we are not like that. God is different. He lives by faith. God operates by faith. Constantly he's like that. And Abraham began to catch on. Before God means by looking at God, observing God, and by his relationship with God, he began to learn faith. He understood this one thing, that God is one who calls those things that be not as though they were. So he was ready. He said, all right, if you're going to call me Abraham, the father of many nations, I will not hesitate then. Doesn't matter who laughs at it. Doesn't matter if everybody says, how come you call yourself father of many nations when you don't even have a child? I don't mind. I will call myself that. Because since you do it like that, I will do it. I want to be like you. Hang everybody else. I want to be like you, God. I just go with you. I'll just do it like you. And he began to live by faith, calling those things that be not as though they were. That's how he learned faith. But look at this. Look at how he learned hope. Next verse, verse 18. Who contrary to hope, in hope believed. In King James Version, it will say, who against hope believed in hope. Now, the word hope appears twice in that verse. Who against hope believed in hope. Now, back off a little bit. When you come to faith, there are two kinds of faith. One is the faith that you have as a worldly person. Everybody lives by faith. When you climb a bridge, leave the service and go climb this bridge, you don't get off from your car and shake the bridge and see if everything is firm, you know. You believe that they've built the thing pretty secure and it'll hold all the weight that is applied on it and you can get across to the other side. You confidently just run through it, just fly through that flyover, you know. Because you believe what they have done, right? Your boss said he'll pay you on the first and he gave it to you in writing. Now if somebody comes and says, what is that piece of paper worth? You're going to believe this and work 31 days this month, you know. Well, you believe, everyone believes that employment order and goes to work and works 31 days and receives the salary only on the first because of that piece of paper. They believe that. See, we all exercise faith. We all live by faith every day. You believe your wife believes you. You believe your children believe you. You believe your boss, you know. You believe those who work under you. See, we all exercise faith in a certain way, right? That is faith in the natural level. But Jesus said to the disciples, remember when he cursed the fig tree and Peter said, Lord, the tree you cursed is withered away. Jesus looked at him and said, have the faith of God, he said. In other words, he says, Peter, you only know this worldly kind of faith. Now you begin to learn my kind of faith, the kind of faith that I have. Have the faith of God. Now where do you get the faith of God? The faith of God comes from God because you are born of God.
Let's clap our hands. When you sing, just sing it like a prayer, all right?
this place.